All right. Good morning, family. How are we doing this morning? All right. It's such an honor and just so great to just be in the house of God. Amen. It's good to come as if, you know, this is a hospital for our spirit, right? Because we need to be restored. And whenever we're feeling sick, we go to the hospital. Whenever we need to hear a word from God, we just come to be surrounded by our brothers and sisters who believe in the one and only true God. Amen. So if you could just rise to your feet before we get started with our praise and worship. Turn to your neighbor, say good morning, neighbor. Shake your neighbor's hand. Give him a hug. Tell him you look great this morning. Good morning, servers. Woo. All right. Thank you, Jesus. Let's go ahead and just pray before Father. Our Lord in heaven, we thank you for this opportunity we have, Father, to come together as a family, Lord, to just open our hearts and give you all the praise and all the glory for being with us throughout this entire week, Father God. We are here standing, breathing, living because you woke us up this morning, Father God. We thank you, Father, for this time. Bless this house. Bless our pastors. Bless all of the servers, Father God, and bless your people that are making their way here, Father God. Guide them safely. We say these things in your Son, Jesus Christ, and all of God's children say, amen, amen, amen. Now, this first song is a little bit fast for us, but you know what? We're going to give it a try. Yeah? So put your hands together. Come on. Let's all get into it this morning. Hey, hey. You guys ready? Are you ready for us to give it a shot? Where's the team? Here we go. And get it up, get it up.
Oh,
seat with us. Yes. In Jesus' name, fill these chairs. In Jesus' name, fill this seat next to me, Holy Spirit. Yes. Woo. How many know that God is a great God? Tell your neighbor, God is a great God. He has done wonderful and miraculous things in my life. Yes. Come on, put your hands together like this. Say, oh. Oh, oh, oh. Give a shout of praise. Come on, say, great on.
Great are your ways. Great are your works. Great are you, Lord, in all the earth.
Great is your power.
Great is your power.
Strength.
Great is your strength. Great are you, Lord, and great to be praised.
Great are your ways.
Great are your
works.
Great are your works.
Come on, say,
great are you, Lord, in all the earth.
Your power.
Great is your power. Your strength, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Your greatness, your famous name is exalted in all the earth.
Glory, glory,
glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory to the God of Israel. Glory, glory,
come on,
hallelujah. And all the earth will sing that you're a great God.
Who believes that he's a great God? Father God, We just thank you, Lord. We want to give you the honor that you deserve. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hope like no other. Hallelujah. thank you, God. We thank you, Jesus. We remain in your presence, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus.
Your breath in our love.
Thank you, Jesus.
In our love. Jesus. We pour out our praise to you, Jesus. Great are you, Lord. We say great,
great are you, Lord.
Come on, Destiny Family, just say great are you, Lord.
Are you, Lord?
You're so great. Say,
great are you, Lord?
You're a great God, we say.
Great are you, Lord?
Oh, you're great. Remove the veil from us, Father God, so that we can see everything that you want us to see, Father God. Keep us bold and strong. God bless our pastors, Lord, and this house. We thank you, Father, and all of God's children. Say amen and amen and amen. Come on, put your hands together. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
All right, all right. Before you're seated, find 25 people. Find 25 people. Give them a high five, give them a fist bump or a hug. Tell them welcome to the house of the Lord this morning.
Are you, Lord?
breaker.
That's all we say today, Lord God. That's all we're going to say. Greater is the Lord. Great is the Lord. You are worthy to be praised, Lord God. You are worthy to be honored, Lord God. Great is the Lord. Great is the Lord. Let Hawaii know that great is the Lord. Let your families know that great is the Lord. Let Destiny Christian Church know that great is the Lord. He is worthy to be praised. Come on, let's give the Lord a big hand. Woo! Hallelujah! You are worthy, Lord God. You are worthy, Lord God. Great is the Lord. Great is the Lord. Great is the Lord. I don't know what situation you may be facing in your life, but great is the Lord. I don't know what's caused you to be depressed, but great is the Lord. We are victorious in Him. We thank you, Lord God, that great is the Lord. May our lives reflect our gratefulness to you, that great is the Lord. Great is the Lord. Okay, find five people, give them a high five, and go sit down. I gotta preach. Woo! Sit down. I'm gonna save my reading for a little bit. Yeah, before we start, I want to thank those of us who were able to make it yesterday. Really want to thank the Toele family, our youth team, the Fuimaonos, the Sofenis, the Tuisamata, our youth team, for really spearheading the church to do this outreach. And I want to say thank you so much. But I just want to show you one of our guys brought his drone so you guys can see a little bit of what happened today. So this is a video we wanted to share with you before we get in our message.
Gotta keep it real simple, keep it real simple. Bring everything right back to ground zero. Cause it all comes down to this. Love God and love people. We're living in a world that keeps breaking. But if we wanna find a way to change it, it all comes down to this. Love God and love people.
Amen. So just in case if you weren't able to make it, and if you can't make it because you work, hey, no condemnation, no guilt. But for some of us who are thinking, you know, I can't make it because I had something, well, guess what? We're doing this every month at the last Saturday of every month, so you'll have an opportunity to come out and pray for us as we continue to do this. I really believe it's a blessing. We had one family that was there, their older couple. That went to visit their, always come to visit a gravesite, but they're always afraid they're going to fall in a hole. And if you guys ever walk there, you'll see that there's a lot of gravesites that are actually, you could probably see the corner of the casket. And so we're going to try to ask some of our union friends to help us with filling the dirt and filling some of these pukas, because some of these older folks who go out to pay tribute to their loved ones, they'll fall in the hole, they'll get hurt, they may die. So. And that's the only reason why we ask not to have children there, only unless they're mature and able to be responsible, because there's a lot of danger. So, but thank God. Good job, church. Good job. Before I get into a message, let me review last week, and then we'll get into our reading, okay? So last week, we talked about fearing God only, trust God fully, and live life fearlessly. Everybody say, fear God only. In other words, it said, don't be afraid of those who want to kill your body. They cannot touch your soul. Fear only God who can destroy both soul and body, right, in hell. So that's why we're not afraid to go to graveyards and turn them into gardens. Amen. There's nobody there, no spirit there that can condemn us to hell or send us to heaven. That's why God says to fear him only. So some of the people say, oh, well, we need the kahuna to come and bless the flesh. No, no, we got believers. Amen. That believe in the Bible. And we believe that we don't need to fear anybody except God himself. Right. And then we talked about trusting God fully. He said, what is the price of two sparrows, one copper coin? But not a single sparrow can fall to the ground without your father knowing it. And the very hairs on your head are all numbered. In other words, he's into the details. He is the administrator of our lives. He's very well organized. He knows what he's doing. And there's some things that are insignificant and unimportant to us, like sparrows costing, how much it costs a sparrow, or how much hair, or no more hair on your head, right? Little, I mean, insignificant, unimportant things that you think, who cares about that? God does. Amen. He's into the details. And so you can trust God fully when you're on a mission for him. And then we talked about living life fearlessly. He said, don't be afraid. You are more valuable to God than the whole flock of sparrows. What is he saying? He said, because you are valuable to me, because I love you a lot, because you are valuable and precious to me, you don't have to fear anybody. Live life fearlessly. Don't let the rejection hold you back. Don't let the haters hold you back. You move forward with the mission that God has blessed you with. Amen. So with that, I want you to stand to your feet as we read the reading of God's word this morning. Matthew chapter 10, verses 32 to 36. We got only two more weeks of this message, this chapter, and then we move on to 11 and 12, which in just 9 weeks, we're going to finish two chapters. Everybody say, yay. And then we're not even halfway point yet. All right, so everyone who acknowledges me publicly here on earth, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But everyone who denies me here on earth, I will also deny before my Father in heaven. Don't imagine that I came to bring peace to the earth. I came not to bring peace, but a sword. Everybody say a sword. I have come to set a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. Your enemies will be right in your own household. This is the reading of God's word. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. So if you've been following our series, we've already had 6 messages, and this is the 7th. And so just to give you some context, the first message was an extraordinary mission by ordinary men. And then Pastor Carlos came with basic training for disciples. I wonder where he got that basic training from. And he talked about the ABCs, attitudes, beliefs, and character. And then Ace came out and preached a great message called Operation Sheep, Life Among Wolves. The following week I came and said, my calling, I was born for this. Everybody said, I was born for this. And then Pastor Carlos came back, rejected by man, redeemed by God. Powerful message. And then last week I preached on remember who you are. And then today I'm ministering this message entitled Public Policy, Acknowledge Me or Deny Me. Acknowledge me or deny me. God gives you a decision or a choice. So, because I'm getting into my poetic side, let me wrap this up to give you some context. The willing and obedient shall eat the good of the land, an extraordinary mission for 12 ordinary men, commissioned to minister to their own people with love and to win their hearts with basic training from above. For attitudes, beliefs, and character matter greatly to our Lord. Obedient and faithful disciples will receive their great reward. Operation Sheep has us living among the wolves, being wise as serpents and gentle like doves. Our primary calling to glorify the King, secondary calling family and provisioning. Not good English, but that's okay. Rejected by man and redeemed by God, for if you're facing rejection, then you're probably doing your job. Fearing God only and trusting him fully, remembering who you are and living life fearlessly. Going into your world is not just our wish, but a calling from above. We were born for this. A public policy from heaven is to acknowledge just before men, so when the day of judgment comes, it's you he'll be representing. Amen and amen. Come on, somebody. DJ Joe. This is DJ Joe. So 4 observations this morning in our text. The acknowledged, the denied, the sword, and the enemy. The acknowledged. The first one, verse 32 says, everyone who acknowledges me before he publicly here on earth, I will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. In other words, acknowledge him in all you do. Oh, but Pastor, my Christian walk is a private Christian walk. And then you're only half right. Because there is a privacy to our walk with the Lord. There's some things that you can't get at church that you can only do in the privacy of your own home. when you pray, when you study and read the word. You know, you growing up and maturing in the Lord is not dependent on your pastors. It's dependent on you taking the word of God from your pastors and go practice it and go apply it. So, amen. Right? See, we live loud. We're called to live loud for God. And yet, we'll live loud for our junk teams. We'll live out loud. We'll wear our jersey. We'll fly flags on our trucks to represent our team. And we live loud and proud for our teams. Even in the political season, we live loud and proud for our politics. Yet, are you living loud for Jesus? Is Jesus someone that you're proud of? See, your Christian walk is both private and public. There's a private side, right? And a public side. There's two, and you need two. You need both of them. But in this context, the Bible says, if you don't represent me while you're here before men, then when you stand before the Father on judgment day, when the judge is sitting behind his seat with a gavel, and he's going to say whether you're guilty or not guilty, I want Jesus to represent me. I want Jesus to be there. And the Bible promises us for those who surrender their lives. Notice that I say those who are perfect in their lives. Anybody perfect here so we can worship you too? Yo, I can guarantee you, Pastor Carlos is not perfect.
Amen.
Okay? That's what the wife said, Pastor Vanessa. Wrote. My wife will tell you that I'm close to it, but not perfect at all. She says, she's over here kamumuing over here. All right? So the thing is, that God requires us in our faith to let our light shine, right? He doesn't want your light to be covered by a basket. He wants the light to shine. He wants you to be salt of the earth, to bring flavor to the earth, to bring purification to the earth. Shine your light and not hide your light. See, Jesus will be loud and clear about your commitment to him on the day of judgment. How would you want Jesus to represent you in the court of law? Very closely. And with power and with wisdom and authority. That's the kind of attorney that I want on the day of judgment. Is that God says, you know, you can come in. Welcome to your home, your eternal home, because you represented my son on earth. See, those who are bold and proud are those that receive the free gift of salvation. See, salvation is free. It's totally free to anyone. How many of you know the guy on the cross, the thief on the cross, who admitted that he deserved to die, but this man is innocent? And he told Jesus, can I come to you? Can you remember me when you get into your kingdom? He says, you will be in my kingdom. Now, a lot of people will tell you, oh, you got to do this and do that to get saved. No, you believe in the Lord Jesus, you shall be saved. Amen. You tell me any otherwise, you tell me how you rectify that theology right there. He made it simple. It's because salvation is free. But to follow Christ will cost you everything. Amen. To follow Jesus will cost everything in you. See, when I went to college, I couldn't afford it. My parents could not afford me going to college. But thank God for my athletics that I was able to get a full scholarship to the University of Hawaii. So I signed this thing called the National Letter of Intent. And so when I signed the National Letter of Intent, man, my tuition was free. There was a long line to the administrative office for people to pay their tuition. But for those of us who were on scholarship, it was free. In fact, when we went to the dormitory, there was a long line for people to pay for the dorms. My dorms was free. My meals were free. All my books were free. Okay? They were totally free. Why? Because I signed the dotted line. But can I tell you that for the next 4 years at the University of Hawaii, I don't own my time. It was free. But to be a warrior of the University of Hawaii football team, I had no say as to what time. They tell me what time to show up to the meetings. They tell me what time to show up at study hall. They tell me where to go, where to eat, where to sleep, when to sleep, when to wake up. See, a lot of people think just because you're on full scholarship doesn't mean that you don't have anything required of you. Some people think that you get salvation, you can do anything you want now. Yeah, your salvation is free. But it costs you everything to serve him. And it's the one that are actually sold out to God that have said, God, I am so unworthy of you, but because of your grace and your mercy in my life, I receive your gift of salvation. And it's to those that understand that now I want to serve you. I don't want to just pray a prayer and say that I can be a Christian. I want to serve you with my life. My life is no longer my own. It belongs to you 24/7. God, what do you want me to do? Tell the person next to you, man, I think the Fifey is talking to you right now. Pastor's talking to you. So that's our first part, the acknowledge. Acknowledge me and I will acknowledge you. Deny me and I will deny you, which leads us to our second part. Verse 33, but everyone who denies me on earth, I will also deny before the Father in heaven. Now, if you deny Jesus in your life, when it comes judgment day, you are on your own. But worst of all, you will be denied. It's one thing to know that you're not going to make it. The whole other thing for Jesus is that, no. Look you in the eye and says, no. He never represented me on earth. Yeah, he may have gone to church, but he never really wanted to share his life with anybody else. See, we live in a generation where everything is about self-indulgence and self-promotion. Everything is me, me, me. And yet, in our Christian virtues, it's all about self-sacrifice. It's about self-denial. It's about giving things up for the glory of God. That's why I appreciate those of you who have been engaging us with our community, because it takes the 3 hours out of our Saturday. I don't know about you, but Saturday mornings are valuable to me. I would rather sleep then go work at a graveyard. But I know that part of the virtue of a Christian and understanding that Jesus is my Lord is that I'm to shine my light, I'm to share my gifts. Now, don't be condemned. If you weren't there yesterday, don't even worry about that. I'm just saying that part of our responsibility in reflecting the love of Christ is to share our lives, to sacrifice, and to give up sometimes. That's why I love our volunteers at our church who come early and pray. Some of you don't realize you're still snoring. Or you may be eating breakfast while some of our people are already here praying. They're already here preparing. You think our music team just come up here and then don't practice? No, they sacrifice one night out of the week on Thursday nights so that they can rehearse, so they can invest their time so that when we come here on Sunday, that our worship is pleasant. Trust me, not everybody has worship team that can sing like ours and are gifted as ours. We are blessed. Trust me, we've traveled to 30 nations in the last 10 years, and I can tell you the truth, there's some churches that no more worship team. Well, they get worship team, but they just don't can sing. They make a joyful noise to the Lord, but there's no joy in my heart when I'm listening. So anyway, so the thing is, you got to understand that there's a choice. You have a choice whether to represent Christ or to deny Christ. See, God gives us a choice. Deuteronomy 30:19 tells us that I call heaven and earth to witness against you, that I place before you life and death, the blessing or the curse. And yet God says, choose life in order that you may live. He wants you to choose life. Matthew 6:24 says, you cannot serve two masters. Either you're going to love the one or you're going to hate the other, or hate the other and love the other one. But you cannot serve God and mammon. Cannot. You can only serve one. Joshua told the people of God in the assembly of all the people, he says, you choose this day whom you will serve. But for me and my homies and my boys and my girls and my wife, we're going to serve the Lord. Amen. We're going to choose to serve the Lord. You're living in a time right now that it is not cool to say that I choose God. I choose Jesus, but not in this house. We choose Jesus, even though people may not think it's cool. Oh, this is just a crutch. No. It's a God that has transformed my life. I owe him everything. Amen. Right? Matthew 7:13-14 says that it's going to be broad as the road that leads to destruction, and many will find it, but only a few will find the narrow road. Only a few. Slap the person next to you and tell them, are you part of the few? Yes, you are. Everybody say, yes, I am. See, when you choose him, you choose life. When you choose Jesus, you choose life. When we invest an hour and a half of our time to make our way to come to church, or maybe 3 hours for youth who put on the makeup and all that stuff, but it takes time, right, to come to church. But there's something that happens when you do come to church. When you choose Jesus, you choose life. And sometimes the Holy Spirit will speak on things that has nothing to do on the surface about what you're going through. Then all of a sudden the Holy Spirit says something, and you're totally lost, and God ministers to your soul. The third part is the sword. Everybody say the sword. The sword. Don't imagine that I came to bring peace to the earth. I came to bring peace, but a sword. I have come to see a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. Now, I shared this last week, that part of my testimony with my wife is that the biggest enemy I had when I first gave my heart to the Lord is my mom and dad. They could not see that. Why are you carrying the Bible? I grew up Catholic, so we don't carry Bible around, except the big Holy Bible in the middle of the living room, a big one. But I love my Catholic upbringing because I at least grew up respecting God. But that was my biggest stumbling block, was my parents. But they began to see how I lived my life with my family, and they eventually started coming to church on Friday nights with smoke machines and loud music, with lights flashing, with all the youth, the 300-400 youth that would come every week at Word of Life. They would come Friday night just so they could hear the son preach. They fell in love with God. Come on, somebody. So the only reason why I think he brings a sword is because there's no middle ground. You're either going to be sold out for God or you're just not going to be lukewarm for God. And the Bible tells us in Revelation that being lukewarm is not a good place to be. It's not a disposition that you want in your life. You're either going to serve God with all your heart or you're not. And you know, I'm the type, my wife will tell you, what she loves about me is that whatever I'm going to do, I'm going to do with all my heart. If I'm going to live my life for the devil, I'm going to live my life for the devil. Okay? And you can't tell me otherwise. But I knew when the day was going to come, when God brought that sword, and I had to make a decision. You still want to act like you're cool? You still want to be the man, the party man all over the place, and have people look at you that you're the man in the nightclubs? Or are you going to serve me? And finally start fulfilling the call of God in your life. Lord, I surrender. I ran. Pastor Carlos Stinky Popolo, he's faster than me. I'm faster than him. I'm faster than this black man right here. I ran, and you could not catch me. God could not catch me until one day he caught me. And I said, I give up. Joe, your wife is going to die. Or your oldest daughter might die in this birth. Not sure any of them can make it. What do you do when you start running? Can't run anymore. Because I wanted control of my life, and I could not control that situation. I finally said, okay, God, you sent so many preachers my way to preach to me, and I disrespected them. And yet, Lord God, if my wife and my daughter comes out healthy, I promise you, I will surrender. God, you know me. When I serve with all my heart. That's all I know how to do. I'm all in. And when my daughter came out, Talia was born, my wife was healthy, it was a new day because there was a new heart. And God can do the same thing for us. I don't know where you're at in your life. Maybe God has been chasing you down. And like me, you fast. You get moves. See, I fast, but I don't want moves like Pastor Carlos. Pastor, he can give you the juke. You may be trying to juke things, but there comes a point where you can't juke anymore. You have to come to the reality that there's a reason why God has you on this planet Earth. There's a purpose and plan for your life. God has a plan. There's a calling on your life. And when you finally get to the point where you say, you know what? I give up. I surrender. And it's then when you acknowledge that you are weak that you become strong. That you realize that I need you, God, in my life. Amen, somebody. Final point, the enemy. Your enemies will be right in your own household. Now, if your family is here with you, don't look at them. Don't look at them, okay? Yeah. But you got to understand that the issue of God and serving God has always been an issue throughout the Bible. In Genesis, Adam and Eve's sons, the oldest brother kills the younger brother because he was jealous that God received his worship and his sacrifice and not his. He was jealous. And there's jealousy in our sibling rivalry sometimes. Jacob and Esau. Remember Jacob and Esau when we went through the book of Genesis? Man, Jacob was a twin brother holding onto his brother's heel. He was a deceiver. The oldest brother was going to receive his oldest child blessing, and yet he faked it. He put hair. Come on, somebody. I mean, you know, that's some drastic manipulation, right? And that guy wanted the blessing. He did it, whatever he could to fake out his dad. And he did. And yet there was friction between both of them. And there was a time when he went to look for a wife, and he found a wife, but he found that the father-in-law was more of a deceiver, a better deceiver, and a better crook than he was. Come on, somebody. Yeah, this is the father of our faith. Everybody, thank God I'm not perfect. He's not perfect, I'm not perfect, right? So Jacob and Esau, Joseph and his brothers. Joseph had a dream, and he became very powerful, and yet the brothers were the very one that tried to kill him. See, this family feuds all throughout the Bible. Absalom and Ammon, they had different moms. But Ammon ended up raping Absalom's sister. So Absalom kills the brother Ammon. And then after that, King David had to go chase his son down. Broke his heart. The prodigal son and the older brother. The prodigal son takes his inheritance, splurges it out there in the world, and he's eating with the pigs. Then one day he says, you know what? I've sinned against my father and I sinned against heaven. And I'm going to go back to my father. The father sees him from afar, the Bible says. The father picks up his lava, and he runs to his son. And he runs and he embraces his son. And he loves on his son. And he tells his servant, give me a robe. Robe this man. Give me a ring. Put a ring on his finger. Go kill the calf and make the emu. We're going to do the umu right now. We're going to cook a cattle. And what happens? The oldest brother's like, I've been here serving you, Lord, Dad, faithfully. And now you never killed me a calf. You only killed one small little pig, but not the calf. What's up with that? Jealousy. If you look at Jesus, Jesus came amongst his own people. I used to think for so long that it was the Romans that killed Jesus. Romans didn't kill Jesus. They were in power. But they allowed the culture that they conquered to carry out things the way they wanted to carry it out. It was his own people. The Jewish people were the very ones that turned him in and rebelled against him and rejected him and killed him. The very ones. So understand that there's going to be a line drawn. And this is where I told myself, I said, whether my mom and dad, whether my brothers and sisters, whether any of them agree with me or not, I need to serve God. And you know, by serving God, many of them came into the kingdom. Every time my sister's in town, they come here to worship. And every time I'm in the mainland, they come and listen. No matter how far they got to drive, they'll come so they can hear the word. They want to see that this little knucklehead boy is a preacher now. Cannot believe the guy who used to party and he's a womanizer out there in the clubs, and then now look at him. Look at that. How you figure? Cannot. That's just how God rolls. So understand that this is a public policy. I'm not talking about something that is a public suggestion. Public policy. That when you acknowledge him, he will acknowledge you. But if you deny him, he will deny you too. In conclusion, Jesus emphasizes the importance of public acknowledging him as Lord. He promises to acknowledge those who do so before his Father in heaven, but would deny those who deny him. He also speaks about the sword he came to bring, which will set family members against each other, and the reality that our enemies may be found within our own households. This passage highlights the importance of standing firm in our faith, even in the face of opposition, and the necessity of acknowledging Jesus before others. As followers of Christ, we are called to be obedient and faithful, even when it may be difficult, and to remember that our ultimate allegiance is unto God alone. Father, I thank you so much for your word. Thank you, Lord God, in Jesus' name, that you would continue to speak to the hearts of your people. If you're here this morning and perhaps you've never, ever surrendered your heart to the Lord, perhaps this morning will be the morning like my wife and I, I had when my oldest daughter was born. I want to lead you into a simple prayer by surrendering your heart to the Lord, saying that from this day forward, you may not understand, but from this day forward, Lord, I surrender everything to you. In fact, I give up running, and I surrender to you. If that's you this morning, pray this prayer with me. Or perhaps you prayed this prayer in the past, and I just want you to pray along others that are praying this for the first time. Say, Lord God, this morning, I'm so grateful for this opportunity that you've tapped my shoulder again and you've grabbed my attention again. But this time I'm not running. This time I surrender. This time I give everything up. All that I am, all that I hope to be, I entrust it into you. Lord, I surrender my heart. I surrender my life. I surrender my soul to you. Would you be the Lord of my life from this moment forward? With every head bowed, and eyes closed, if you pray this prayer with all of your heart and you say, Pastor Joel, and I give up, and I prayed that prayer with all my heart. With every head bowed, and eyes closed, when I count to three, just raise your right hand. 1, 2, 3, raise your right hand. Good. Father, you see these hands, Lord God, both on the right and left of me. Pray that in Jesus' name, the seed that you've planted in their hearts and their soul, that Lord God, that you would take that seed, and that Father, that you would water it, and that Lord God, you would see the fruit that would come forth from this decision that they make this morning, that you would transform. And I pray that they will acknowledge you and not deny you. We love you, Lord God. In Jesus, my name. Amen.
Put your hands together for God's word this morning. Somebody say hallelujah. Acknowledge me or deny me. Pastor Joe mentioned that you have a choice. Majority of the choices you make in life have consequences. And at the beginning of being saved, I always wondered why God didn't just make Adam and Eve obedient, not have them have a choice. But you know, it's not love if there isn't a choice. Some of us who are married knows what that means. You chose to love that person you married. Whether you knew what their future was going to be or not, you chose to love that person. You're born a family, but you choose the one that you love. So the same goes when it comes to our tithes and offering. There's so many ways you can give. You can text DGCLY to 77977. The push pay is also up, and the bucket is going around from our ushers. But what I want to talk to you about is from the Matthew 6:24. No one can serve two masters, for you will hate one and love the other. You will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and be enslaved to money. We have choices in our life. Our tithes and offering is no different. You can choose to give or not. But the difference is blessings come when you do give. And that blessings is found in Malachi 3:10 when God said, test me. Test me and see that I will not bless you. So when I'm talking about tithes and offerings every time, I'm not just talking about, you know, just give out of a habit of giving. No, I'm talking about giving because you choose to. It's your choice to. And you have to understand that he promises that he will bless you when you do decide to give. Father God, we thank you for your word today. We thank you for your love, your blessings. Father, we thank you for who you are in our lives. We ask that you bless those who give faithfully, who give freely, and most of all, who give their time and their money to you, Father God. In your name we pray. Everybody say, put your hands together for PC, Pastor Carlos.
Wasn't that a great message? I noticed something. Ace wore shoes just now. Things are happening. You know, when Pastor Joe was sitting down there talking about running and being fast, you know, when I was growing up, you said, and if you roll red shoes, you had better be fast or could fight, right? Or both, right? And so he's sitting down there talking. I'm sitting there looking at him as he's talking, and I'm like, he got on red shoes. That boy was running. He was running, right? But the other thing I realized is I always did tell you I had a struggle as I got deeper into ministry, because as I read God's word and I listened to messages, something wasn't lining up with me. And God said, be patient. Be patient. Trust my process. And today, I heard my senior drill sergeant delivered God's word. See, God's word ain't about making you feel good. It's about making you do good. And too often we got what made us feel good, but we never did good. This word makes you makes you do good. You acknowledge where you're broken and you begin to cry out to God to heal you, to fix you, to renew you, to restore you to being who God created you to actually be. And sometimes we stay away from tough messages because it's in your face and we want people to like us. We don't care if you like us as long as God loves us. That's all that matters. You come here to get God's word, not to get your needs met, to get God's word so you can go out there and live victorious, right? A drill sergeant can't tell a soldier what to do if they're not doing it themselves. And you can't tell them that the enemy is your friend, because they're not your friend. They're trying to kill you. And if you're not living for God, then you're an enemy of the kingdom. And that's what we heard today. Pastor dropped the mic. Let's give him a big round of applause one more time. If you deny me publicly, then I'm going to deny you, period. You need to acknowledge Jesus. Don't be sitting down there with your bumper sticker on, cussing people out. You get out of your Jesus car and go cuss somebody out like, it don't work like that. You either all in. You know, my dad is something else. He's something else, right? And my daddy used to tell me when I was growing up, he said, son, you're either pregnant or you're not. I'm sitting there looking at him like, what the? Man, I can't get pregnant. But that's just a Southern thing, right? They got all kind of phrases. When he said you're pregnant or you're not, he says you make a decision and you stick with that decision regardless of what goes on. If you choose to serve God, then you be that way, whether you're in the public or whether you're in the private, you serve God. You acknowledge. I didn't say go hit somebody in the head with the Bible. Yep. Oh. No. People will hear us louder with their eyes than they ever hear us with their ears. What we show shows who we are. Stand to your feet so we can get out of here, because Pastor got me fired up. I want to go some more. Right? When you get messages like this, how many people really getting fed? I mean, you really getting the word in you and you beginning to understand just what God's word says. Right? I mean, he unpacked a lot of nuggets. A lot of nuggets. And he done turned into a rapper. I'm sitting down there like, look at here. MC Joey Joe. Woo! It, Pastor Ann, yep. She got some moves, right? So you say, listen here, we're going to rap, bro. He said, rap? You mean like a sandwich? No, with lyrics! Father, we just thank you. We thank you, Lord, as you continue to shine your light ever so brightly in each and every last one of us. We continue, Father, to learn and to grow. So we've been equipped. We've been inspired. And Father, we're ready to send your people out here to live a victorious life. Not because of us, but because of you. So we ask that you bless us all. Keep us safe, and until we can come back together again, we give you praise, we give you honor, and we give you glory. In the mighty name of Jesus, the church in agreement say, hey, one quick announcement for you. On the 3rd of March, we got youth night. Make sure you bring the youth out so they can love up on God. Amen. Go in peace. We'll see you next week.